Welcome on this Palm Sunday to the online worship service of Fairfield Presbyterian Church. I have for you a few announcements. You'll find this coming week, Holy Week, we celebrate the Good Friday services here at Fairfield Presbyterian Church as part of the Bay Shore cluster of churches. It's a community Good Friday service. We will also be recording all those messages. So for you who don't feel comfortable coming in the sanctuary, this will be online for you as well. Also, next Sunday is Easter, and we hope that you will join us here in the sanctuary for that worship service. By the way, thank you for all of you who purchased flowers. They will be here in the front of the sanctuary to decorate this church. Now, for this service, we trust that you will join us, but note you have the opportunity at sunrise, 6:30 a.m. at Sunset Lake, the Bridgeton Christian Ministers Association will lead a worship of service in Bridgeton. Sunset Lake, please join us. By the way, next Sunday there will be no Sunday school classes, so please note that. Now let's prepare our hearts for worship, for the true and living God calls us to worship, and on the home page you'll find all you need to participate in this service. Hear now this prayer of preparation. Listen to my cry for help, my King and my God, for to you I pray. Amen. Our gracious God calls us to worship. Please hear this call. Receive it with faith and in joy. God has ascended amid shouts of joy, the Lord amid sounding of trumpets. Sing praises to God. Sing praises. Sing praises to our King. Sing praises. For God is the King of all the earth. Sing to him a psalm of praise. God reigns over the nations. God is seated on his holy throne. The nobles of the nations assemble as the people of God of Abraham. For the kings of the earth belong to God, and he is greatly exalted. And now you'll find embedded on the home page, as you pause the service, you can sing with the online embedded him, crown him with many crowns. And now, pray with me. Heavenly Father, we come to you, and we come through the person and work of Jesus Christ, our Lord, the one who has been deemed by you, according to your word, the King of kings and the Lord of lords, the one to whom all the rulers of this earth will bow down and will lift up his name, for he is the Lord God. We pray, O Lord, that we will bow the knee now. And for those who now lift up Jesus as the sovereign Lord, we pray for grace to worship him in spirit and in truth. Give us joy as we sing praise on this Palm Sunday, as we shout Hosanna, just like those who saw Jesus enter into Jerusalem in triumph. And we thank you, Lord, that though he entered in triumph on the colt in meekness, yet Jesus will come again with power and glory, the rider on the white horse coming in victory to receive his people to himself. For these things, Lord, we praise you. And now we give you thanks for the Holy Spirit, by whose power we lift up our hearts, we lift up our hands, we lift up our voices in praise. In the name of Jesus Christ, we come. Amen. You'll find a reading in the order of service. Pastors the world over will preach from this passage, and like the others that cover the narrative of the triumphal entry of Jesus into Jerusalem, I've chosen to read Mark 11, the first 11 verses. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and just as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'What are you doing?' tell him, 'The Lord needs it, and will send it back here shortly.' They went and they found a colt outside in the street, tied at a doorway. As they untied it, some people standing there asked, 'What are you doing untying that colt?' They answered as Jesus had told them to, and the people let them go. When they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks over it, he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, while others spread branches they had cut in the fields. Those who went ahead and those who followed shouted, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest." Jesus entered Jerusalem and went to the temple. And he looked around at everything, but since it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. Beloved, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And you'll note that Jesus comes in humility and meekness, but our king is not weak. He is not a king of weakness. And we will see that in this morning's message. Triumphal entry. Do you believe in the Lord Jesus as sovereign Lord and Savior? And now we come to our Heavenly Father to pray. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, as we come through this holy week, we celebrate the season of Easter. We thank you, Father, for the truth of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, for that makes all the difference in the world. If Christ is not raised, as the apostle said, we are foolish people, and we are still in our sins. We are the most miserable of men. And so we thank you for the truth that Jesus Christ is the eternal Son of God, who went to the cross for our sakes, who was crucified, died, and was buried, and on the third day he rose again according to the scripture. Lord Jesus, we do pray that you would grant the gift of faith to many, that they would hear from the heart the message of the gospel of Jesus, that they would have the Christian hope, the hope of resurrection, that one day you will come and receive to yourself all those who have believed in you. We thank you, Heavenly Father. We pray, O Lord, for this time of the year that there would be peace, O Lord. Peace, yes, as the world gives, temporary cessation from fighting and power struggle. But we pray especially for the peace that Jesus gives, the peace not like the world tied to circumstances, but the peace that surpasses all understanding, that comes through the gift of faith in the gospel of Jesus Christ. Father, we pray for those who are struggling in whatever way. We see people on the border seeking freedom from corrupt governments and violence in their nation. We pray for our advisors and our president and those administering that situation on the border. We pray that you give them wisdom mediated with compassion. And Father, we do pray for people to be wise as they would set out to seek freedom in the United States. Help us, Lord. Help our leaders to do well in fixing this broken immigration system. Father, we thank you for your mercy and love. We thank you, Father, for the fact that you bring comfort to those who are grieving. There are people, Lord, who have lost loved ones at this time of year. We pray, Father, for widows and widowers and families grieving the loss of loved ones, that you would comfort them with the comfort that comes through Jesus Christ our Lord and the hope of the resurrection. Father, we pray that at funeral services there will be presentations of the gospel where faith would be granted as a gift. We thank you, Lord, for the kindness you've shown us. We pray, Father, for the many people who are working as part of your plan of redemption to share the message of Jesus. Open and blind eyes and unstop deaf ears to hear the message of the gospel in Jesus Christ our Lord. To your glory and the saving of many, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And now, if you would, please turn to the book of Revelation, chapter 19. Not the usual passage for a Palm Sunday service, but you'll see why I've chosen this passage. And the book of Revelation translates the word apocalypto. Sometimes people will call this book the apocalypse. And really the word means literally to reveal something. And what we find is God, you know, through the angel and through Christ that comes to John, who is exiled on the island of Patmos. Literally there is a pulling back of the curtain between what's taking place on the earth, persecution and hardship for God's people, and what is taking place in heaven. The curtain is pulled back, and in heaven, there's not chaos, there's not pandemonium, they're not trying to find some alternate plan, but there is worship. And then we see the Lamb who is slain, who opens the seals to the scroll, and we find that what takes place on the earth, from Christ's first coming to the second coming, is nothing more than the will of God. And we see that there is, yes, suffering on the part of God's people, but in the end, we triumph because we are children of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. So let's pray for the message to bless hearts this morning. Heavenly Father, we are grateful for this message that John received on the island of Patmos. We thank you for his faith and for his being in worship on the Lord's day. And we thank you for the visitation of Christ and the angels who showed him this incredible vision. We pray, Lord, as we look to it, that we would be blessed, for that is the promise of the book of Revelation. Blessed are those who hear and keep the words of this prophecy. So help us, Lord, to preach it. Help us to hear it, receive it, believe it, and keep these words. These things we pray through Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Revelation 19, we pick it up at verse 11. Then I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse. The one sitting on it is called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he judges and makes war. His eyes are like a flame of fire, and on his head are many diadems. And he has a name written that no one knows but himself. He is clothed in a robe dipped in blood, and the name by which he is called is the Word of God. And the armies of heaven, arrayed in fine linen, white and pure, were following him on white horses. From his mouth comes a sharp sword with which to strike down the nations, and he will rule them with a rod of iron. He will tread the winepress of his fury, of the wrath of God the Almighty. On his robe and on his thigh he has a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Then I saw an angel standing in the sun, and with a loud voice he called to all the birds that fly directly overhead, Come, gather for the great supper of God, to eat the flesh of kings, the flesh of captains, the flesh of mighty men, the flesh of horses and their riders, and the flesh of all men, both free and slave, both small and great. And I saw the beast and the kings of the earth with their armies gather to make war against him who was sitting on the horse and against his army. And the beast was captured, and with it the false prophet who in its presence had done great signs by which he deceived those who had received the mark of the beast and those who worshipped its image. These two were thrown alive into the lake of fire that burns with sulfur. And the rest were slain by the sword that comes from the mouth of him who was sitting on the horse, and all the birds were gorged with their flesh. Dear friends, this is the word of God. Thanks be to God. In the Palm Sunday narrative, believers in Christ celebrate the remarkable meekness of Jesus. And on this day, preachers will highlight the true humility of our King, Jesus. And rightly so, and especially because of the manner of his entry into Jerusalem. But the manner of his entry is also the fulfillment of Scripture. In Zechariah 9:9, we read, Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. Righteous and having salvation is he. Humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. Be encouraged by this, beloved. Our Lord Jesus is meek, but he is not a weak king. But at the time of Jesus' entry into Jerusalem, those in power, the religious leaders of the Jews, the priests, the scribes, the teachers of the law, they were not impressed by this entry of Christ on the back of a colt. Rather, they were offended at this. They had rejected Jesus' claim that he was the Christ of God, the promised Messiah. And when he received the cries of the people who went before and after him, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord," the Jewish leaders, especially the Pharisees, saw this as blasphemous. In Luke 19, verse 39, we read, "And the Jewish leaders, especially some of the Pharisees in the crowd, said to him, 'Teacher, rebuke your disciples.' And he answered, 'I tell you, if these were silent, the very stones would cry out.'" So not many were impressed by this entry of our king into Jerusalem on the first Palm Sunday. Now, in contrast with the text that we have just read, John records for us the entry of Christ into this world at the end of the last days, the day of the Lord that will come like a thief in the night. Though highly symbolic, the image of this coming Christ is impressive. This time he comes as a rider on a white horse, his robe dipped in blood, his eyes blazing like fire. That this image is symbolic is seen in the description of the many crowns, the diadems that grace his head, and the sword that comes out of his mouth, with which he will strike down the many nations and rule over them. The reality of his coming is far greater than any symbol could present. This depiction of the Messiah was the kind of manifestation and the kind of a Messiah that first century Jews had envisioned that the Messiah would be. And so when they see Jesus coming on a colt with his followers, praising him as the Son of David, as the one who is the Christ of God, they are angry and offended. You see, they missed the scripture, the promise of a suffering Messiah who would bear the sins of his people and bring salvation not just to the Jews, but to a broken and fallen world, as his followers would go into all the world to make disciples of all the nations. Because subsequent to the work of the Lord Jesus Christ, the devil is bound. He is bound with respect to his deceiving the nations, and the work of gospel messengers will be blessed, and people the world over will come to faith in Christ. And there are many signs that people look to which might indicate the coming of Christ, but the greatest of them all is that this gospel of Christ will be preached into all the world, and then the end will come. Now, there is another contrast in this chapter of Revelation. Here in verse 17, we have a call to a meal. Come, gather for the great supper of God. Earlier in this chapter, we have an invitation to a wedding feast. Revelation 19:9. We didn't read this passage, but we read, "Blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb." And there you have it. The great supper of God and the marriage feast of the Lamb. Two different meals. One that represents judgment and death and destruction, and the other salvation, eternal life, and eternal joy. The great supper of God is reserved for all who reject Christ and all who are indifferent to the person and work of our Savior. You don't want to be a part of that meal, beloved. On the other hand, the marriage feast of the Lamb is by the way of grace. It is a gift of God, and it is something to rejoice in, something to receive with joy, and we receive the invitation by faith in the person and the work of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so on this Palm Sunday, make sure of your invitation to the wedding supper of the Lamb. Make sure that it is secure. How? By repenting of your sins, acknowledging your need for forgiveness, and believing that Jesus is the promised Christ of God, who whose work on the cross and whose perfect obedience wins for you forgiveness and a righteousness not your own, all received by faith. And when Christ comes as the conquering King of Kings and Lord of Lords, believe that he comes for you and for all who have faith in him. Let us first consider the blessing that is found in the book of Revelation. The book of Revelation is not an easy book to study and understand. But that being said, we also have to acknowledge that it is not impossible to understand. But I believe that it is more confusing to understand in our day because of a popular view of Revelation that imposes a literalistic view on a text that is highly symbolic and figurative. Now, this popular view also interprets the book as a linear chronology, with all the chapters from 4 to 22 as being still in the future, with some absolutely astonishing fulfillments that they perceive as they look in the daily news and the newspapers for evidence of that. And of course, these will be fulfilled after the church is raptured or taken from the earth. Now, while it is impossible to give a definitive interpretation of such a complex book in a short time, I do want to consider some things that mitigate against the popular view of the day. To begin with, we must see this popular view of Revelation of holding to a linear chronology as a Western mode of thinking and logic. The Hebrews were concerned more with presenting the meaning of an image and concept, and they utilized the structure of parallelism. This is a Hebraic literary device to drive home the concept or meaning they wish to convey. Now, at Fairfield Church, we are studying the book of Revelation using the videos by Dr. Robert Godfrey from Ligonier Ministries. And he sees seven cycles that are parallel, and each of the seven cycles has seven parts to them. And these cover the redemptive work of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit from the time of Christ's first coming until his glorious second coming as the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Dr. Godfrey demonstrates that the enemy of God's people mimics the Trinitarian work of redemption by a response seeking to thwart the redemptive work of God on the part of the devil, the beast, and the false prophet. Father, Son, Holy Spirit, devil, beast, false prophet. In light of the persecution of believers on the earth that was taking place at the time that John was exiled in Patmos, that was part of his persecution. He was there for his testimony of the gospel of Christ. And so we see persecution on the earth by the hand of the devil and his minions working in governing authorities. You see then the curtain between heaven and earth pulled away, an apocalypto, an apocalypse. And you see that there is maybe persecution and chaos, so to speak, on the earth, but in heaven, glorious and ordered worship. And then you find the Lamb who was slain, who opens the seven seals of the scroll depicting the revealed and the secret will of God, the will of God for his people. And we learn in the book of Revelation that, yes, Christians will suffer even until Jesus returns. To one degree or another, Christians will suffer because of this broken and fallen world. But our suffering is mitigated by the knowledge of a sovereign God, a God who loves us, and a God who is present with us by the power of the Spirit through all the trials that come from the throne of the Lamb that was slain. And then we find that the one who is sovereign has suffered more than anyone could ever suffer in this broken and fallen world. Jesus went to the cross for our sakes. And it makes sense here now, because Dr. Godfrey will point out that while believers suffer in this broken and fallen world, the unbeliever suffers much more. You know, that makes perfect sense when you consider that our suffering is something that Christ endures with us. But think of it. The person that doesn't have the Christian hope, the person that doesn't have the comfort from the Spirit and the Word of God, they have to endure just suffering and pain and the thought of the brokenness of this world without any comfort from God's Word or Spirit. Now, let me give you two particular reasons why I believe that the popular view is not a proper interpretation of the book of Revelation. First is the promise with which the book opens. In Revelation 1:3, we read, "Blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of this prophecy, and blessed are those who hear and who keep what is written, for the time is near." Notice, those who read and also those who hear the words of prophecy, they are blessed. Likely, there were few that were reading and many who were hearing, because not everyone had a Bible such as we have today. We have multiple Bibles in our homes and even on our computers and electronic devices. But the Bible was to be read to the people by a pastor or by a teacher, a Bible teacher. But here is the question for those who hold the popular view. What blessing could there ever be for those who read this book and hear this book read in the first century, if chapters 4 through 22 are still, even at this present time, yet for the future? How can that bring blessing to these people? But we understand that Revelation speaks to the church in every age. And so the blessing of Revelation for those who hear and keep what is written is for believers from the first to the 21st century, in whatever century Jesus chooses to come victoriously as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. So the blessing at that time was especially for those who were experiencing persecution. And the blessing was near. What was taking place was near to them because it was being fulfilled even at that time. And what was especially near was the Holy Spirit bringing comfort from the Word of God. Something, dear friends, we have available for us today. But the second reason why the popular view, I don't believe, is a biblical understanding of the book, and that is that the first century readers and hearers were to understand something about the second beast that arises out of the earth in chapter 13. This beast mimics the work of the Holy Spirit. This beast moves those who deny Christ to worship not Christ, but the first beast. Revelation 13, verse 15. This beast was allowed to give breath to the image of the beast. You see that? The breath. You know, the reference to the Spirit of God, which is the breath of God. This beast was allowed to give breath to the image of the beast, so that the image of the beast might even speak and might cause those who would not worship the image of the beast to be slain. Also, it causes all, both small and great, both rich and poor, both free and slave, to be marked on the right hand or the forehead, so that no one could buy or sell unless he has the mark, that is, the name of the beast, or its number, or the number of its name. Listen, this calls for wisdom. Let the one who has understanding calculate the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man. And his number is 666. Now, Dr. Godfrey, I think, handles this ably. And in the study guide that comes along with the videos, let me give you some things I've gleaned from there. And with respect to the reference of the mark of the beast in Revelation 13, 18, it says, "This calls for wisdom. Let the one who has understanding calculate the number of the beast." Now think about it. This statement indicates that the number of the beast is a truth that is accessible to any Christian who possesses wisdom and understanding. And the Apostle Paul, in several of the New Testament letters, speaks of Jesus, in whom is the thesaurus of wisdom and knowledge. And that we have been given the Holy Spirit so that we may know the mind of Christ. So the average believer, if he will seek it, can have that wisdom by which he will understand this mark of the beast and this number of the beast. Moreover, this number must also be something that the first century Christian could figure out. Consequently, it refers neither to a secret nor to a person born centuries later. And we all know that proponents of the popular view have named from time to time. The popular view was only popular at the end of the 19th century and rose to popularity through the 20th century. So how could first century Christians or people who didn't have this popular view, how could they have wisdom and understanding to know about the beast and the mark of the beast if that was something yet future? And we all know that despots from all over the world have been identified as the beast, who is again known as the Antichrist. So this doesn't make sense that the first century Christian could have understanding of this passage, again, if the beast was someone to be identified in particular centuries in the future. And so rather than attempt to identify a historical figure, we find in Revelation 12 and 13 that Satan always attempts to imitate, to mimic the work of God, but he is unsuccessful in doing this. And so the number of the beast is another instance of the devil's counterfeit tendency. Well, the number of God's perfection is seven. And dear friends, only a cursory reading of Revelation reveals that the number of seven is given time and time and time again. So that God's number of perfection, the number of completeness, is something that the devil cannot attain. And so Christians can thus be encouraged that although the beast may cause havoc for God's people, he will never ultimately succeed in his purposes. Number of seven is a number of perfection and completeness. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, the Holy Trinity. The unholy Trinity, the dragon, the serpent, who is the devil, the beast, and the false prophet, the unholy Trinity. 777666. That's it, dear friends. And so we shouldn't try to find, as some have tried to do, assigning to letters, numbers, and then looking at the numbers or the names of someone like Nero and seeing if Caesar Nero adds up to the number 666. If you leave out one of the letters of his name, it does. But that doesn't make any sense. Now, this brings me to the text that I preached from or that I read from this morning. And that is the battle that never ends, and the tale of two meals. The popular view eagerly depicts the battle of Armageddon on the plains of Megiddo in Israel. And the usual image is that of an army, Gog or Magog, which is interpreted as Russia. Or also you might find the armies of Red China, or perhaps Iran joining this army that will come to Megiddo. And what we find is they are fighting as one global force. And the image that comes to mind, and perhaps even some popular movies have drawn up, is that of tanks and aircraft and weapons of all kinds. And then we read in chapter 19, verse 19, "And I saw the beast and the kings of the earth with their armies gathered to make war against him who is sitting on the horse and against his army." Now, this passage is parallel to a passage in Revelation 17, verse 11. "As for the beast that was and is not, it is an eighth, but it belonged to the seven," and that is the seven hills of the Rome. This is a depiction of the scarlet beast on which the woman sits. But did you catch that? "The beast that was and is not, it goes to destruction. And you compare that with Revelation 1, verse 4, because this revelation is from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne, compared with the beast that was and is not and goes to destruction. And then verse 12 in Revelation 19, or Revelation 17. And the 10 horns that you saw are the 10 kings who have not yet received royal power, but they are to receive authority as kings for 1 hour together with the beast. They are of one mind, and they hand over their power and authority to the beast, and they will make war on the Lamb, and the Lamb will conquer them, for he is the Lord of lords and the King of kings, and those with him are called and chosen and faithful. And so we see here, the devil has manipulated this world system, the false religion, and authority is given to armies that come against the beast. But get this, whenever you hear of this battle of Armageddon, you see the armies against the Lamb preparing for battle, but you never hear or read of a battle. How can they come against the true and the living God? And I'm reminded of Martin Luther's hymn, and though this world with devils filled, we're not going to fear. We're not going to tremble. Why? Because one little word shall fell him. So the armies of the world, the one world government, whatever the armies are, of course, it's the world. They come against the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. They are preparing for battle. But you don't read of any battle in Revelation. Why? Because they are destroyed immediately. And so we see the earthly authorities in league with the dragon, the beast, and the false prophet. They prepare for battle, but there is no battle mentioned. And that is because these kings and their armies are destined for the great supper of God. How about this? Verse 17. Then I saw an angel standing in the sun, and with a loud voice he called to all the birds that fly directly overhead, "Come, gather for the great supper of God, to eat the flesh of kings, the flesh of captains, the flesh of mighty men, the flesh of horses and their riders, and the flesh of all men, both free and slave, both small and great." And I saw the beast and the kings of the earth with their armies gathered to make war against him who was sitting on the horse and against his army. And the beast was captured, and with it the false prophet, on who in its presence had done signs by which he deceived those who had received the mark of the beast and those who worshipped its image. Those two were thrown alive into the lake of fire that burns with sulfur, and the rest were slain by the sword that had come out of the mouth, or from the mouth of him who was sitting on the horse, and all the birds were gorged with their flesh. Get that. If you're going to attend the great supper of God, note this. The kings, the captains, and their mighty men, and their horses, their flesh is the meal. Their flesh is that on which the scavenger birds will gorge themselves. But then, when we consider the feast to which God's children, God's believers, are invited, we read in Revelation 19, verse 6, "Then I heard what seemed to be the voice of a great multitude, like the roar of many waters, and like the sound of mighty peals of thunder, crying out, 'Hallelujah, for the Lord our God, the Almighty, reigns. Let us rejoice and exalt and give him the glory. For the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready. It was granted her to clothe herself with fine linen, bright and pure. For the fine linen is the righteous deeds of the saints.' And the angel said to me, 'Write this: Blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb.' And he said to me, 'These are the true words of God.' Then I fell down at his feet and worshipped him. But he said to me, 'You must not do that. I'm a fellow servant with you and your brothers who hold to the testimony of Jesus. Worship God, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. And so you see, beloved, how God, as Satan seeks to mimic the Trinitarian God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, the dragon, the beast, the false prophet, and the people of God invited to a great feast, the wedding feast of the Lamb, the party of parties. Here you find the enemies of God invited to the great supper of God, and they and their flesh is the meal. Beloved, to which supper will you go? Receive the Lord Jesus this morning. Believe in him. Reaffirm your faith in him. Trust in him and believe that you are righteous. Do you see that? The saints are clothed with fine linen, bright and pure, and that reflects the righteous deeds of the saints. We are righteous by faith in Christ, and from that righteousness, not our own, that we receive by faith, we do deeds of love and righteousness. Heavenly Father, we pray for your blessing upon this message this morning. May your people who have gathered rejoice to be children of the King, and may they reaffirm their faith, or for the first time, affirm faith in the person and work of the Lord Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. And now you'll find our closing hymn on the homepage of Fairfield Presbyterian Church. All hail the power of Jesus' name. And now, dear friends, receive this benediction. It comes from the revelation of John. Grace and peace to you from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth, to him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood, and has made us to be a kingdom and priest to serve his God and Father. To him be glory and power forever and ever. Amen. And now you'll find the Gloria Patri on the home page. Thank you for joining with us on this Palm Sunday. The Lord bless you this day.